I am yours. thank you that Jesus, you are mine. Amen. Put your hands together, give him another praise in his house. Give me some more mic. Give me some more mic than this. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We thank him for another day. Welcome to Dove Church. We thank him for this time to minister and to share the word of the Lord with you. We welcome you into this house by way of whatever media outlet you see us on. And while we were in President's Conference last week, some of you came and said you follow us and you listen. And so we thank God for you, and we bless God for you. And we thank him for what he's imparted to us to say to you in these hours and in this time. God is just good to us. Amen. The announcer at the end of this program will give you information on how to give. And we do encourage you to give. We bless this ministry. Send seed in. It's a good place to send seed into. It's good ground. We do a good work, and we thank God that he's with us in this work. And we love him, and we appreciate him, and he is our stay, and he maintains us, and we bless him today. Amen? Amen. Amen. You ready for the word of God? Everybody with your Bibles in your hand, and whatever device it's on, let's say this confession together. This is my Bible. I am who it says I am. This book calls me an overcomer, and that's who I am. Today I shall be taught the infallible, unchanging word of God. So my mind is alert, my heart is receptive, as I gladly receive the word today. I believe that faith come by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Amen. Amen. Sound good. Let's pray. Father, in the wonderful name of Jesus, we thank you for this day. We thank you for what you alone can supply to us. And now, Father, we speak as an oracle of you, and we declare your glory in this place over and over and over again. And we just believe, God, that you are going to move sovereignly and that you are going to bless. And so we rebuke everything on assignment to stop and to block. We claim repentance, we claim deliverance, we claim overcoming victory in the name of Jesus. And we declare that your will be done in the earth. And so now, Lord, let the word of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. And they all said, amen, amen, amen. Again, last week I mentioned it earlier in service that we attended the President's Conference in Pittsburgh last week, Pastor Marcy and I, and that was right on the heels of her sponsoring and spearheading a wonderful 70th birthday celebration. To all of you that wished us a 70th birthday, we say thank you so much. We appreciate you. We got your cards and your notices and your letters and your well wishes, and we appreciate you, and we thank God for you and what you said to us and what you imparted to us. It was just a blessing. Amen. And God is good. To reach 70 and to still be able to move and have your being and do all right, God is good. Amen. And we thank him that 70 is the promise. It's not the ending, but it's the beginning. And we thank him that he lets us see the promise. And all this week, I told the Lord, thank you for the promise being met. Amen. Because a lot of people don't even see it, you know. They really don't. It's amazing. We buried so many people and so many friends, but God has been gracious, and he allowed us, which means that there is work to do. And one of the preachers said something last week. I wanted to tap into this. I might have to all the next month we're just, I'm not going to say steal stuff, but we're just lifted and work with it. And he said, you don't have a right to die unfinished. You keep courting sickness and all kind of stuff because you think that's what you ought to do. But you can't say you finished until you're done. And you're not done. And you don't have a right to die unfinished. Some people say, I finished my course. No, you didn't. And sometimes we declare we're done before we actually work. I'm done doing this. I'm done doing that. You keep canceling your own self out. When in actuality, if we think about God, He never done. Jesus said he was finished. But he was talking about one phase of his work, the redemptive plan. But he's still working in heaven. Okay, that's not the message today. Look. Oh my God. Well, y'all got enough of that. I love it. My God. The title to today's message is, guess who's coming to dinner? Guess who's coming to dinner? Guess who's coming to dinner? Without a lot of introduction, I'm going straight to our text scripture. And this is going to be the place that we're going to work the rest of the time that we're ministering. And it's Psalms 15, 1 through 5. If you get drowsy, stand up. Don't let me have to ask you. Just because that's what happens when the word, you need to be moving. You need to be up. You need to be attentive. You need to be listening. An enemy comes to steal your hearing because he know that breeds faith. Amen. Psalms 15, 1 through 5 in the Message Bible. If you have Message in your Bible rundown, and you should get the Bible app because you get more than one version of the Bible. You get the Passion Translation, New King James, King James, NASB, NIV, a lot of things, and in particular the Message. And sometimes we flip through because they bring it to current language that you can understand. And so we won't be stumbling over the King James version. Now, people get twisted and tore up because they said, if you don't read King James version, that's not the Bible. Well, there's a special word at the end of King James, and it says version, which means it's not the original Hebrew or Greek. Amen. All right. All right. And I don't think the Lord said thee, thou, and though, and you know, it just was not said. Amen. That's the language of 1611 England. Amen. All right. Psalm 15, 1 through 5 in the Message Bible. He said, God, now this is the psalmist David. He's saying, God, who gets invited to dinner at your place? How do we get on your guest list? Here comes the answer to the question. Those first two questions. How do we get invited to dinner at your place in your heavenly presence? So when it say in your place, he's saying in your presence, really. How do we get invited to your presence? And then he says, how do we get on the guest list. Are y'all there? Well, the next thing start off, the next trilogy. This here comes a trilogy of things. Walk straight. Act right. And tell the truth. Now you know this is a preacher all by himself. Walk straight. Now there's some people that's not here that need to hear this. Walk straight. See, that's why I like the message, because the mother version said it another way. I said, no, we got to act right. And tell the truth. Say them with me. Walk straight.
Act right. Tell the truth.
Now here comes some more. Don't hurt your friend. Don't blame your neighbor. Despise the despicable. Keep your word even when it costs you. Make an honest living, which implies that there is some dishonest stuff going on. Tax evasion or whatever is just some. Never take a bribe. Oh, this is a mess today. Yeah, never take a bribe. Somebody whistling at you. Psst, come in. Never take a bribe. And then here is the outcome. You'll never get blacklisted if you live like this. In other words, you'll never hit the list where the other non-invitees are. That's what that means. It opens by saying, and let's unpack some. God, who gets invited to dinner at your place? The New King James Version says it this way. Who can abide in the tabernacle, the place where God dwells? Who gets invited to dwell with God? Well, we think we just automatically go in because we're saved and we love God. But there are some requirements to getting on the guest list. In ancient custom, a guest was sheltered from all harm who got invited to dinner at your house. That meant when you came into their house, they had a responsibility to guard you. They wouldn't let nobody mess with you. They wouldn't let anybody come in the house and snatch you out. Amen. You were sheltered by the host. Yes. His person, the person was seen as worth something. And while he was in a guest in the house at the dinner, his needs were met.
Yes.
Now he didn't invite him to the table and have steak, shrimp, lobster, and Vienna sausage. And when you came in, you said you can only eat the Vienna sausage. Because the host wanted to make sure that everybody's needs was met and everybody got the best of what he had to offer. Because he gave you an invitation to come into his presence. Come on, come on. I can't stand going into folk house and they act funny when you hit the door. You say, oh God, I don't even feel welcome in here. You stand at the door and they never say, come in. But ancient custom was they welcomed you in. And boy, got new revelation on washing feet too. And they washed your feet because most people wore sandals and they had road dust all between the toes and stuff. And they washed their feet as a sign that you are well. And they didn't say, throw your foot up on that stand and let me dab at it. You actually took the person's foot in your lap with a towel and you washed it and you dried it off. And in some cases, if you were well off, you rubbed in scented oil and stuff. You wanted to make them comfortable. And that's what the Lord does to you. When he invites you in, he wants you to feel comfortable knowing that I intend to be good to you. You in my house. Anybody want to be in his house? Guess who's coming to dinner? But there are a few prerequisites or requirement to getting invited to dinner. In our modern culture, we are invited because of prominence, stature in industry, or celebrity. Those get you invites to White House and Buckingham Palace and to visit the Saudi Arabian high-ranking folk. Because you're somebody. You over a company. So you get invited. But according to the psalmist, God as host has requirements for those who come to dinner in his house. His requirements are your personal characteristics. He's not interested in what you are in the world as much as who you are as far as a moral person or somebody that has made godly choices. So he says, here is my requirement for people coming to dinner and for people getting on the guest list. Walk right, straight. Act right. Tell the truth. Don't hurt your friend. Don't blame your neighbor. Everything go wrong with you, somebody else did it. And then he says, hate sin, despise the despicable, hate sin, not the sinner, hate sin. And Pastor Marcy and I talk about that over the course of time, if there's some things that are not right in your life, you must grow to hate it if it's against God. See, you can't pity pat and dabble. Before I came up, I was having a conversation about people. We church, but we church in church, but outside of church, we something else. Okay, all right. And then another one I want to list here, make an honest living. Those are requirements. Make an honest living. Honest living. Something that doesn't graze your conscience or you're not looking over your shoulder every day wondering what's going to happen. I stand in front of this church sometime when I'm here, sometime alone and sometime out in front, it's a little busy. All kind of commerce is going on. One day I asked, is this the stock exchange? come walking out, they never ask me, who are you? But because the way I'm walking, they say, uh-oh, he connected to that building right there. I may be in jeans and a t-shirt. Uh-oh, he connected to it. They'll start talking to me. Sir, I'm just trying to get a phone signal. And that's when is it going to roll up in the car? what are you doing? And they start taking off. I try not to live dangerously. And sometimes I have my phone in my hand. And I had to be careful because I want to lift it up and do like this and start. Just to see which way they're going to scatter. But I just. I'm talking about making an honest living that doesn't graze your conscience. You've cheated no one. Let me go on. Under the old covenant, the disobedient soul should not expect blessings, inclusive of the blessing of God's presence. However, speaking prophetically, when David wrote this psalm, he addresses a different ground for blessing, and even though we don't see Jesus in it, he is right in the midst of it. Because as we run to the end of the book, the Gospels, and in Revelation, there is an identification of a wedding supper that folk are invited to. And through this wedding supper, you get invited because you meet the requirements, but then you are in relationship. Under the new covenant, faith rather than performance is the basis for blessing. You believe God, so you include it. And to believe God is to believe his word. What do you believe in God for? Walk straight, to act right, tell the truth, don't hurt your friend, don't blame your neighbor, hate sin, make an honest living. Whew. So you're not working to get something, you're working because you already have it. The conduct of one's life is a reflection of his fellowship with God, or should be. It's a place of work. That line right there is a place of work. You're constantly working to make sure your fellowship with God is good. To act right is a fruit of obeying God's word, making godly decisions. That act right thing carries a whole lot of connotation to it. My God, because we think we have a right to act up under that's who I am clause. But it's not so. You need to act right. Everything don't need the judgment of your tongue. So shut up. We say stuff too quickly. Then we say, up is out. No, you been a mess. Amen. 1 John 1:6-7, and this is NASB, New American Standard Bible, 95 edition. If we say that we have fellowship with him and yet walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. Like Pastor and I were going over a list of things people say when they really not committed to doing something. You coming? Yeah, I may be coming. They're not coming. I'm thinking about it. They're not coming. What time is it again? They're not coming. What were some of the other ones, Myers? Do you? Yeah, what is it? Yeah, yeah. Oh, that really not coming. Let me get back with you. Let me pray. That's the religious one. Let me pray about it. You praying about coming to a barbecue at 5 o'clock. Or coming to prayer at a certain time. You're not coming. But we just can't make ourselves. What is one of them? Okay. Work with me here. Tell the truth. And without excuses. But sometimes we make folk lie. Oh, I can't just tell them that. That looked too bad. So we'll dress it up. My God. We lie and do not practice the truth. Continuing reading of this 1 John 1:6-7. But if we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we have what? We have what? That means we are relationally tied with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. It's amazing that truth and cleansing of sin walk together. My God. We have fellowship one with another. And our fellowship should be truthful to each other. No, I don't like this. That's why kids mess us up, because they blunt. Do you like this? No. That's nasty. I tell this story all the time about my son. We were at a meeting, his mom and I. And we always took Lou with us. I don't know why. He always cut up. He wasn't bad, but he would just, he'd tell the truth and he'd see everything. He'd be recording just like a camera. And the lady had made some macaroni and cheese. And his mom and I were sitting in front of him, and she had, I almost said, you foolish woman. She asked him, LaVoy, I said, why aren't you eating your macaroni and cheese? And Lou looked up and said, that macaroni is yuck. By that time, Pastor and I, you're not supposed to laugh, but we were holding each other and vibrating. Ooh. Ooh. You know why we were laughing? Because we wanted to say the same thing. But we got grown and old and got filters. Well, he filtered less. He just know. And she didn't know what to do. She said, what? I said, this foolish woman, you should have left him alone. You didn't know he was crazy. My grandkids the same way. He just as honest. Honest, you know that. What they don't. If I mess with them too much, they just say, "Stop it, Poppy. Just stop it." You'd have told me stop it so evil one time. I backed off of him. Tell the truth. The desire to walk straight and act right produces a truthful heart. My God. Matthew 12:34, NASB. Jesus rebuked them, and he said, "You brood of vipers, how can you, being evil, speak what is good? For the mouth speaks out of that which fills the heart." What's in your heart comes out of your mouth. Ooh. People always apologizing for what they said, but it's in your heart. Sometimes somebody will say, "I'm sorry," and then I have to say, "I'm sorry too." Because it's in your heart. Sometimes people have to help you with that. So if it's in your heart, that means there's a whole nother something you need to do to work that out so it doesn't come out. Because what in you comes out. And it shouldn't always come out. A sign of maturity is that you know how to lock stuff down. All of us have stuff that we shouldn't let out of our mouth. Oh, God, let me come on this side. Say, come on, come on. Yeah, yeah, you want to say it. And you know what? You're right for saying it, but you're not. Or you should say it. Because it's not good to say. Because after it's out, what is the repercussion? Because the damage it will do is almost irreparable. You can't pull it back. And people will remember that when they don't remember nothing else. And you going on to something else. And they said, "He called me. They told me." And you're trying, "Can we all get along?" Nobody want to be Rodney King with you. You know, you ain't. So you have to watch the words you say and how you say them. Somebody speaking, you say, "Hello." Well, you really didn't want to say hi. Come on. But that's a place of maturity too. Oh, oh. 1 John 3:18 says, "Little children, let us not love with word or with tongue, but in deed and truth." Indeed, not let us work, but indeed. Not tongue indeed. I'm talking about in activity and truth. Your actions tell what's in your heart. Ooh. Ooh. You can tell somebody, "I love you all day," but until you show them, they won't believe you. They got to believe you through an action, a deed. I'm hungry and you telling me I love you. Gone with that. Does that make sense? I'm in need and you're telling me, you'll be all right and pat me on the head. First of all, I'm not a puppy. Be genuine. Woo! Let me go. Can I go on to the next one? Don't hurt a friend or backbite. Why? I'm not going to even deal with that whole backbiting thing because this person said that. Then you go to that person and say, "What did they say?" After you heard what the other one said. So you compare notes. But you're not an intermediary. You a mess in the middle.
Yes.
Does that make sense? And here's what happened. The ultimate goal is to damage the church and its work. Hold your tongue before you are quick to criticize another. And here lately, there's been a rash of ministries or ministers that have had problems. And one of the ministers, his son, stood up in front of a church that he had served for, his dad had served for years, and said, "My father has been there for all of you all. He buried your dad. He counseled you. He kept you out of divorce court. He did this. He did that. He did that. But soon as a failure shows up, then he's completely erased or eradicated." And that's not by the world. It's by the church. What's wrong with us? Quick to criticize. Now, sometimes you criticize stuff and you don't know the whole story. You don't know the whole story. Sometimes you do not know the whole story. And sometimes people will only bring you a sliver of the truth, and you make a total judgment on the sliver. Here is a story. Here's a story. An owner of several chain restaurants walked into one of his restaurants and saw a young man sitting and not working. He asked, "How much do you make a day?" The young man replied, $40. The owner paid him the $40 and told him he was fired. The young man took the money and quickly left the store. Restaurant. Later, the owner asked some of his employees who the young man was. And they told him, "Oh, he was a delivery boy from one of our suppliers." Just fired somebody that didn't even work for you because you didn't have the whole story. You made an assumption. Let me go on. Don't hurt your neighbor. Righteousness is expressed in the way we treat one another. And it's really expressed in how you treat those outside of the fold. Woo! And how you treat new babies in Christ. See, we do a disservice to them because when they come into church, we expect for them to start getting churchy. And they're not there yet. It's going to take time to get something pulled down and something pulled up.
That's right, man. That's right. Amen. Amen.
They might be smelly a little bit. And you know what? But come on. Woo. We start making them churchy when we ought to make them Christ-like. They don't need to be churchy. We need to present a standard so they can walk in it and say, "Oh, this is how." They look at you and say, "Okay, this is what we do." Or they love you enough because you love on them enough. Tell me how to operate with this. Tell me. And then they'll come to you and say, does this look all right? He said, nah, babe, that's not good. This is what you need to do. There was a time when the older mothers in church would say, come here, baby.
Yes. Yes.
Come here. Yes. Come into me. Yes. Come into me. I've seen them do it.
Yes.
And you come in church, you know, all dialed up. And they said, come here, baby. Come here, baby. Come here, let me go to wipe it. We're gonna be all right. Wait a minute. You missing something. Wait a minute. Here, I'll put these on. Take this, put this on. I've called young fellas to me and everything they had on was sideways. Looking great. And one guy just, a friend laughed at me so hard, I snatched him, I said, come here. I retied his tie, his shirt, put his shirt in, closed his jacket. Okay. And he just stood there, letting me yank all on him. He was doing like it. But I never had to do it another time. Because at some point, thank you, the world needs to know that we care about them. And we ain't judging them to hell. Because they don't look like us. And some of the, as quiet as it kept, some of us.
My God.
Does that make sense? Don't hurt your neighbor. We ought to hate evil and not people. Hate sin. To love God, you must hate sin. Hate sin. And I talked about making an honest living. The truth is, God is not a respecter of person. That means nobody does he like better than somebody else. Although you think, God, they so rich, they so this, they have so much. When is it ever going to be my turn? God, and then God gets judged because you think he's not being fair. When some people listen when he talks. See, my thing is, are you a good listener? If you keep missing the instruction, or if you keep skipping school, you're gonna be behind. You keep missing Bible class and wonder, what did the Lord say? Or how do I hear the Lord's voice? Well, first of all, you got to find out what God would sound like. What would he say? What won't he say? Woo! Because there's many voices waiting to be heard in the world, but God has a voice. And he didn't shut up when Revelation was written. Woo! My God. He's still speaking. And it's lined up with everything else he said. It's still lining up with what he said. Luke 14:15-24. Let me rush on. You're getting tired. This. But he said to him, a man was giving a big dinner. This is NASB. And he invited many. And at the dinner hour, he sent his slave to say to those who had been invited. In the ancient custom time, they would invite you to dinner. But they wouldn't tell you what time dinner was going to be. So you assume dinner would be at the dinner hour. Well, in ancient time, dinner hour lasted for hours and hours. So you didn't get the notice of the time of dinner until that day. But you already had the invitation, so you needed to just get ready for when you would get the notice of the day. Are you hearing me? That's scripture. That's Old Testament. And it said, and at the dinner hour, say at the dinner hour,
at the dinner hour,
he sent his slave to say to those who had been invited. Does that bear out what I just said?
Amen.
Come, for everything is ready now. In other words, you can't come to dinner till it's ready.
Amen.
I may be cooking a whole lamb. That's not something you can fry in 20 minutes or 30 minutes like your pork chop.
Amen.
It's a long cooking process. Everything was slow and good. Come on. Y'all work with it. It wasn't microwave and stuff, you know. We got to bake the bread. We got to make this. We got to do this and grind this. And so you can only come when it's ready. God is saying, I want things to be perfect when you get here, because when you get to the dinner, I want all your needs to be met. My God from Zion.
Yes.
God takes time to serve you.
Yes.
What do you do? You don't hit and miss eating meals. But you're hit and miss serving God. Serving something that he blessed you with. So you forget the blesser for the blessing. And then when stuff get to moving, the devil is, no, not the devil. What did you decide to do? Come, for everything is ready. When is the what's the next word?
Now.
It's ready now. Don't show up early, because it's not ready. Don't you hate when you have dinner and somebody, you still working on stuff, and they show up early? Then you got to stop and try to entertain them and cook, and you talking about something get on my nerve. And then they're going to walk all the way around. What you doing? Well, it look like I'm doing. I wish you had heard. And that's when you want to get them, give them some Windex and some paper towel and say, you see all them windows over there, get busy washing while I fit. So I'm telling you, if I invite you to dinner and you show up early, I'm going to put you to work. You're going to be raking leaves or doing something, or picking the weeds or something. Come, for everything now. But they all alike began to make excuses. The first one said to him, I have bought a piece of land and I need to go out and look at it. Did you all hear what I just said?
Yes.
I may be by. I'm praying about it. Lord, have mercy. And I need to go out and look at it. Please consider me excused. Y'all think this sounds lame, but pastors get some lame ones too. We've had some folk that have killed all their relatives. My cousin's cat died. Another said, I have bought, notice it's tied to what they had, the things. Another one said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen, valuable, and I am going to try them out. Pastor, I ain't coming. I got me a new Corvette. I'm driving to Chicago. I'll see y'all when I get back. Is this in your Bible? Because another one said, I have married a wife. And for that reason, I cannot come. Help me, I want to mess with that so bad. My husband, my wife. Well, what did you pray for? A husband, a wife. But dinner is ready. Dinner is ready. When? But my hubby, my wife, the master has called you to dinner. When is it ready?
Now.
Are y'all getting this? Does this make any sense whatsoever? I'm trying to help you. And for that reason, I cannot come. And the slave came back and reported this to his master. All three of those excuses. The land, the oxen, and the wife. Then the head of the household became angry and said to his slave, go out at once into the street and lanes of the city and bring in here the poor, crippled, blind, and lame. Yes. And the slave said, master, what you commanded has been done, and still there is room. Thank you, God. Do you see the mercy of God that even when others still come in on time, he said, I still have room for you to get here. That's the grace of God. More room means I still got space. For you to get to a place of provision and to get to my presence. When? Right now. Without making excuses. Offering up to God what he gave to you as a gift. And an excuse not to be in his presence. Oh, no, you're not going to get this. And we wonder why stuff get removed from us when he said, I'll not have another God before me. That's why Abraham was instructed to take Isaac. Because Isaac was Abraham's seed, but he wasn't the multiplied seed. In this respect, If you just channeled everything around the current blessing Isaac, there would have been no posterity for greater. There would have been no Dora, no Rose, no Yvonne. Because you got to get past what you were blessed with, honoring God so he can multiply the blessing so it could be like the stars and the sand. And we start worshiping the blessing and not the blessor. Ooh. And he can't multiply us because we keep worshiping the blessing. We get a house and we start worshiping it, and a car and we worship it, and land and we worship it, and a husband, a wife, and we worship it, and we forget. But they've been set up as a posterity for the future. Master said to the slave, after he said there's more room, go out into the highway. God. And along the hedges, here comes the mercy of God. And compel them. Compel them to come in. Come here, Rose. No, I'm going to come to you. Servant. Come here. Go get them. Compel them. Come on. Stop resisting. Come on. Dinner ready. You ought to be hungry. Come in. Wrestle them to the feast if you have to. Come in. So that my house may be full. For I tell you, for none of those men and women that were invited shall taste my dinner. That were invited and did not come. Guess who's coming to dinner? The requirements is this: walk straight, act right, tell the truth, don't hurt your friends, don't blame your neighbor, hate sin, and make an honest living. Blessing to you today. Lift a hand and praise God. If you've been invited in, tell God, I'm going to meet the requirement because I'm coming to dinner today. Tell him I'm going to meet the requirement. Tell him I'm going to meet it. Tell them I intend to meet it today. So I want you to bless the blessor today. Bless God. Open your mouth and bless God today. Just tell him thank you. You bless God. Oh, yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you. Bless every hero that they'll be doers today. Thank you that the invitation has been extended, God. And we're coming to your house in Jesus' name. We're coming in. Oh, God. You told us what's required. It's not wealth, not prominence, not any of those things. Ooh. That we love what you love and hate what you hate. God, we love you today. And we give you praise. In the powerful name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Ooh. Ooh. This has been a word of regulation. It's chiropractic. It's to regulate us. Straighten our posture. Come to regulate me and come to regulate you. Thank you for a word of regulation. Yes. Yes. So we don't miss it. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name. Put your hands together and give them a good praise.
To all of our viewers, we are so grateful for the time you spent with us today. We trust this presentation was a blessing to you. We pray that it inspires you and enhances your spiritual learning. Also, we encourage your financial support of this ministry as we continue to reach the world, knowing that God will bless your giving. You can use our PayPal by going to our website, dovechurch.org/giving, and that will take you to our PayPal page. Thanks again. God bless you, and we hope to see you soon. All right.